but it's just called Heart for the House. And our heart for our house is different than what maybe another pastor's heart may be for his house or for their church. And so specifically, these are the things that we feel like is what God is calling us as Vima Church to do. Every church has a little bit different vibe. Every church has maybe different worship. They meet in different types of venues. The pastors are different. They preach different styles. They use social media different. All these different things. And there's not necessarily a right and a wrong. There's a obedient or disobedient. And so these are the things that we feel like that if we're walking in obedience, these are the things that God's calling us to do. And so it may be different than what someone around town is doing, and that's okay because we are going to be who God has uniquely called us to be. And our vision, our mission here as a church is to see Wichita experience the real Jesus. And so for that to happen means we're going to have to continue to do things to love on our city, to continue to do things to serve our city, to continue to preach the gospel and do all these different things. And so we're excited about these things. I could not be more excited about them, and I can't wait to share some of them with you. But before I do that, I want to tell you what we've already done. Because there's some things that we've already done this year that you may not know. You may be new to Vima and you may not know all the things that God's already done through our church in this last year. So our current accomplishments, before we talk about new vision, this is our current vision. This is what we've done. So far this year, we've given over $5,500 to church planting. So as a church who is a church plant, who's a brand new church, we've already invested $5,500 into planting other churches in the U.S. and really all over the world. And that's pretty cool. I don't know about you guys, but I think we can clap for that. I think we can praise God for that because that's pretty incredible. And what's cool about that is that in the middle of a pandemic where a lot of church plants are really struggling, and in fact, our organization that we're a part of, they reached out to us and says, hey, if you need something, we want to support you in this season. Where a lot of church plants are maybe having some difficulties, we've been able to take this season and not take from them, but to continue to give and to build other churches. And that's incredible. I'll tell you this, not only is that incredible, that's a miracle. The fact that we started a church on January 26, had 8 services, got sent home for 3 months for a stay-at-home order, came back and there was still a church here. Came back and then not only was there still a church here, that we kept growing and more people and we got to baptize 9 and we've seen literally probably close to 100 people saved now. I mean, all of that stuff is a miracle of God. And so what you've been a part of, and that's number one on the list. I got to keep going. Number two, earlier this year, during the beginning of the pandemic, we partnered with a church in Peru and a pastor in Peru. They didn't have the health care. Not only did they not have health care, we didn't have toilet paper. They didn't have food. And so we partnered with them, and we sent $1,500 to a pastor who provided a month's worth of meals for his entire village. So the entire village came to church to get food, which was pretty cool. And the pastor was able to be the one to hand that out and connect with those people and love on those people. And we sent medical care, and then we've done some follow-up stuff with them as well. We've also this year, with our local school here that we've adopted, Minahal, we've already done $1,500 worth of investments and care for teachers and support for students and different things, ministries that we've done there at the school. We've sent $1,100 to missionaries that are doing different things. We've got a missionary in Czech. We've got a missionary in town today. Yeah, come on, Abby Kendall's in town for a month. But you're getting ready to go to, did you say Guatemala? Costa Rica. Getting ready to go to Costa Rica after the holidays. And we've been able to partner with her, and she's doing some local stuff in different places in the States, but now she's getting ready to go overseas. And so, and then also through Young Life, and so different missionaries. On Mom's Day and on Easter this year, instead of doing a big service because we were stuck at home with the rest of you guys, we decided we were going to love on some people. And so we let you guys, the church, nominate people that you knew that needed an Easter blessing. And so we just said, hey, we want to egg your friends in a nice way. Not throw deviled eggs at them or anything like that. I'll throw deviled eggs at me because I love deviled eggs. I'll eat them all. Man, what's a Thanksgiving without just a big plate of deviled eggs? Come on now. Anyone else like deviled eggs? Yeah, come on. They smell horrible, but they taste amazing. No, we egged people. We brought them like an Easter basket to just families all over our city and let you nominate neighbors, friends that you knew that were going through a tough time. And so we did that. Then on Mom's Day, we're like, you know what? Let's just do the same thing for moms. Like there's some moms now that they were mom and maybe they weren't too, but now all of a sudden they're the full-time teacher. because all these kids got sent home, and man, moms were just carrying a ton of weight. So we decided to send gifts to moms all over the city, let people nominate their moms. And so through both of those, it was a little over $2,000 that we supported and gave gifts to different people just to say, we love you, we're in your corner. And then during the pandemic, we've done over $1,000 of just pastoral care, it was what I would call it, or pandemic care. People who needed meals, people who needed groceries, people who maybe were laid off for a season and needed help making just pay one bill before they could get back to work. We did some of that for different people all through our city and inside our church. And then, this is really cool, this week, a friend of mine, actually Roger's wife, she posted on Facebook, our drummer Roger, Ashley, she posted on Facebook that her dad is a teacher and that he always likes to do a pair of pajamas and a toy for all his K-5 students. He's a K-5 teacher and has done it for years and years and years, I think, yeah. And so he needed 10 more people to help, to step up, to help, you know, take care of his class. And so I said, I can get 10 people, that's no big deal. So our family, we took 4, one for each of our kids, and I just posted on Facebook, hey, I need 6 people to volunteer, to just take a kid, here's their name, and boy, girl, and here, one toy, one set of pajamas. 128 kids later, you guys won't stop messaging me and asking. That's pretty cool. And I never even said it from the stage. Not once have we taken an offering for this. This is just me posting on Facebook, and you guys just kept saying, how can I help? How can I help? What can I do? Hey, I'll take 2. And so I had so many people lined up. I called them and talked to them and said, hey, what can we do? So they took over K-5. Then we took over first grade, every first grade. And this is one of the lowest social economic schools in our city. So all the K-5s and all the first graders, and then a couple families, like where one brother was getting taken care of, so we went ahead and adopted the whole family. And then we called Minnehaha, our school, and was like, hey, this is the school we adopted. We got to get in with them too. So they sent us 15 different families, 25 kids, that they don't think we're going to get anything, and you guys have already adopted. I mean, it's just incredible. I've turned into your secretary, by the way, for the last week. I've spent so much time on my computer trying to organize names and ages and kids and get them to you guys. And we're still waiting. So if you're like, John, I still haven't got my name. I know teachers are doing the best they can. If you didn't know this, our city voted, the board, school board, that all kids were going to remote learning starting this week. Well, they told the teachers on Monday, and they had to teach a class remotely on Friday. Every one of them, they gave them 2 days to go home and try to figure it out. That's all. And so, man, our teachers are heroes. I don't know if you're like me, but it's been frustrating. I've got kids. It's been hard. But, man, teachers are heroes, and we've loved being able to support them. And then when you have teachers who are doing things like looking out for their kids too, man, that's just incredible. And so that was awesome. So all of that combined gives us a grand total of so far this year, what we've done as far as our vision and mission giving, $15,800 in the middle of a pandemic. Come on, man. That's pretty incredible. $15,800. So in the middle of a season, well, I honestly wasn't sure if we still had a church. I wasn't sure if any of you guys would come back, or some of you guys didn't even come until after a pandemic. We just weren't sure what it was going to look like. God kept doing the work of the gospel. And it happened because of your generosity. It happened because you partnered with us and said, hey, even in the middle of this, there's still people that we can help. There's still people that we can resource. So before I share this with you, I want you to know that this is what God's already done. But a lot of this is a continuation. This is us going, hey, here's the sweet spots where God's like opened up doors and opportunities, and we want to keep stepping into those. We want to keep seeing where this will go when it comes to school partnerships and things like this. So phase one, let me start unpacking this for you. Phase one, we have a couple different things. And so first one, ministry center. Ministry center is this idea that, one, we need to be able to care for people, pastor people, counsel people, coach people, help people, feed people, care for people more than just on Sunday for a couple hours. We need to have a place that Monday through Saturday, we can be the church. Right now, we do have a place. It's called my basement or my couch or a Reverie coffee shop or wherever I can pull up my computer and meet with you. And many of you I've had coffee with, and some of you I'm still trying to connect with. But we just happen to do it all these different places, and this season's been really difficult. 1 week someone's open, and next week they're not open. It's just been crazy. We need a place where we can say, this is ours, this is what we can do. Let's say that I came up here and I felt like God wanted us to do a food drive. Well, if we collected a bunch of food, you know where that would end up? In my truck, in my garage, until we're able to hand it out. We need a place. We need a place that we can do ministry 7 days a week. We need to be able to have a place that we can work out of, coach out of, build teams out of, and do different ministry out of. So that's our ministry center. Being portable, this is only here on Sundays. We couldn't afford to rent this 7 days a week the way that we do it. And so we need a place that maybe is a little bit smaller, like an office space with a big room. We can do different things and that we can do ministry 7 days a week. Next thing, staff and team development. We need to keep growing our team and we need to be able to create places for our teams to grow. Right now, all of our team meetings happen in homes or on Zoom, and those things do not work well. Homes are okay, but Zoom does not function. We need a place for our teams to be able to connect and meet. That falls into this, but we also needed to do some intentional development. Middle school and high school ministry. So this is something that's near to my heart because, one, I've got middle school kids. So here we are as a church plant, and my kids have been super gracious. They've been incredible. Jaden, you and Jonah have been in coming along for the ride and helping us build our church, and they serve every Sunday. And they make kids happen, all the tech stuff. Thank you, Jaden. And they do that. But they need a place that they can have for themselves. And maybe you have friends, or maybe you've got kids that are that age. They need a place that they can worship. They need a place that they can build friends. They need a place where they can experience the real Jesus. Well, this is a big room. You know what would work well with that? A ministry center. Somewhere where we've got some small spaces, but maybe a little bit medium-sized room, a little bit bigger room, where we can start doing some of these things every week to care for our families. And so this directly ties to that. We need to get this going ASAP because I want to do it for my kids and your kids, but my kids especially. The next thing is we want to continue doing what we're already doing with Minnehaw, with Care Portal, which is foster families and at-risk kids, and then our pandemic support. We've done a lot, and just in the last few months, we've been sending out DoorDash gift cards and Grubhub gift cards to people who are quarantined just to say, hey, I know you're stuck at home, and maybe you can't taste, but at least here's an easy meal. We want to be able to keep doing, we want to be a generous church. We want to be people who just, when people say, I need something, we say yes, whatever it may be. Maybe we can't do all of it, but we're going to play a part. We're going to jump in and find something in some way to help you. So phase one is a continuation of kind of what we're doing and what we feel like God is already doing. This is what I feel like we have to do. This is $20,000. This is what we hope to raise for this. $20,000, I believe, would get us in motion for these things. Phase two. Phase two, local survey projects. This would be us going into our city and doing specific projects where we say, hey, not only are we here to serve, but we're going to cover the cost of our serving. Meaning if we go to Minnehaw and let's say we paint some classrooms, we're not going to say, hey, you get the paint, we'll show up. No, we show up with everything. We're there to bless you 100%. When you show up, all you got to do is unlock the doors and we got it. And so we want to do some of these projects where we show up in our city with the relationships that we have and we care for people. We want to not just egg people, we want to egg the park. This year, I believe that the pandemic's going to slow down. It did this summer a little bit. Maybe a vaccine's coming out really soon. I'm praying and believing that we're going to be able to do a big Easter outreach. And we want to do it right here at Edgemoor Park. We got a park that's like a mile away from our church. And around it, there's a lot of families and a lot of homes that could use someone showing up in their community and just saying, we love you. And so bounce arounds, inflatables, all that kind of stuff, Easter egg hunts. And to my surprise, there's not a lot of community Easter egg hunts in Wichita. When we started looking at this year, there's a couple churches that do them like on their property, but not hardly anyone that does it in the community and just says, hey, everyone, come on. And that's what we want to do. Dig a water well. So the church in Peru that we're partnering with, what we want to do is we want to put a community water well in front of the church where when people need clean water, where they need water for baths, for food, for all the different things they need it for, that when they go to get it, where they got to go? To the church. It's where they had to go to get food. So we want to dig a well in front of the church. And so not only is the church providing clean water, they're providing living water where the pastor can love and share the gospel and do that. Those cost about $2,000 for a community well. And then the last thing, young adult internship and ministry training. We've got a lot of people in our church that I've talked with them that say, John, I feel called to the ministry. Like, I want to do more with my life. I maybe want to be a pastor someday and serve in that. Well, we feel a great call to help people take a step into their potential when it comes to ministry. If you see on Sunday, any given Sunday, man, we'll have three different worship leaders. We got like eight or nine different people that lead songs. We got a lot of musicians. We got a ton of people that serve in different capacities, different people that lead the kids' lessons. But we want to see people keep growing. And we want to do something intentionally with that and launch an internship that says, hey, if you feel called to ministry, we want to help you get there. Well, guess what that attaches to? Ministry center. If we got a place to do it, we can do it. We got people that would love to. So this is phase two. These are the things that we feel like we need to do. things that we feel like can happen over the next year. This also is $20,000. So phase three is this. Prison Ministry Services, we've been partnering and talking with God Behind Bars about doing some services at El Dorado there. That can't happen until the pandemic. All that stuff has been shut down for now, but there's potential for that in 2021. Inner city outreaches, this would have no benefit to us other than just being the hands and feet of Jesus, because if we go minister to people at the inner city, they can't get here. We're too far out. They can't walk to us to go to church here, but not always do you do things to serve people to get something out of it. This would be us just going and saying, we love you. I know you have some needs, and partnering with different organizations. Then the last one, Vima Studios, live stream digital discipleship podcast. One of the things that we've discovered in this season is that people don't go to church as much as they used to. We already knew it, but in this season, it's become really obvious that when we're stuck at home, it changes things. And then we start recognizing it's not the same as it was when I was a kid. When I was a kid, man, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, we were drugged to church. We didn't do drugs. We were drugged to church. Like, all the time, we played, did like Awanas and Royal Rangers and Boy Scouts and like church league baseball. And my dad played on a church softball team. We were just around church people all day long. That was the social epicenter of a city, was the churches. Well, nowadays, that's not the case. Like, we compete for people just to give us a couple weekends a year, or a couple weekends a month. And so what we've recognized is this: if we want to see people keep growing in Christ, it may not be demanding that they keep coming here. It may be saying, hey, let's understand what our society is doing, and let's bring them. Our society is a la carte. I do what I want when I want. So why can't we bring some discipleship that way? Why can't we? Well, the way that we have to do that is be able to record it digitally, have podcasts, different things like that, where we help people continue to grow deeper in God's word. And that's what that is creating a studio where we can produce more content to help you have more. If you want more access, we want to give you more content, like, but we just need to bring it to you. Because not necessarily can everyone be here more in the church. Jobs work on Sundays. People work on the weekends. I remember when I was a kid, on Sunday morning, I'm old. On Sunday mornings, not like very few restaurants were open after church. Like, I remember we had to like pick like where we're going to, like, there's Cuco's was open, Pizza Inn was open. I remember my family like go through like, these are the five things in our city that are open because Sundays were sacred for church. It's not the case anymore. Everything's open on Sunday. Society's different. We want to adapt and provide more content for people. So that's phase three. This one is $10,000. So all of that together, if you're doing the math, 2010, that's $50,000. You say, that's a lot of money. It is. It's a lot of money. Remember, we have three categories: have to, need to, want to. We got to do the 20,000. That's something that we believe as a church. We got to get into that as soon as we can. As soon as we can start diving into that phase one, there's things that we feel like God's already doing to be a steward of it. We need to get into phase one. To see it keep moving forward, we got to get into phase one. Phase two are things that we need to do, things that if they, maybe we get to them over the summer, that would be totally okay. Phase three, if we could get to some of this stuff by the end of 2021, that would be incredible. I mean, church would be rocking, and we really believe that this is possible. So what does that mean for you? Well, for us as a church, my belief and my call as a pastor is I believe this. I believe the vision will move as fast as God wants it to and as fast as the church wants it to. I can't push this any further or any faster than what we do together. We're all in this thing together. We don't have a money tree in the back growing money. So this stuff, it's what we do together. And so when I put this stuff out here, this is not me saying we're doing all these things. This is me saying we have the potential to do these things. We have the team to do these things. We have the momentum to do these things. We have the opportunity to do these things. This is a different conversation. If you remember our series on In the Zone a few weeks ago, we talked about tithing. And if you haven't listened to that, go back. You can listen to it In the Zone. That's week two of the In the Zone series. This is different than that conversation because in that conversation, God's word tells us something specifically that he wants from us, that God has a calling for us and how we handle our finances. This is different. This is outside of that. So there's the tithe, which is what God has ordained as what he wants from us. And then this is a conversation that is different because this is a conversation that you have to say, God, what do you want me to do? I can't get up here and tell you as a pastor, here's what you should do. I can't get up here as a pastor and say, if everyone does this, then we'll do it. What I can say is you should talk to God. What I should say is that I believe that the resources that God wants and that God needs to do what he's called us to do are in here. They're in our hands. They're part. They're in my pocket right now. But I have to pray and ask God, God, what is it that you are asking me to do? And so that's the first thing we want you to do is, one, is we want you to pray. Two is that we want you to do this, is to make a commitment, whatever it is. We feel like this is an all-in conversation. That everyone can do something. So commit to what God has spoken to you. So whatever God speaks to you, man, commit to it. Budget it. Find a way to make it happen. For our family, we're taking a little bit of a step of faith. So we can budget it, but it's a little bit outside of our budgets right now. We're believing that God's going to make a way. So we're actually going to step into what's called sacrificial giving. We're going to ask God, God, we feel like you're calling us to do this, but for us to do this, you're going to have to do something. And so that's what we're doing. I'm not saying that's for everyone, but that's an opportunity for you to say, God, what are you asking me to do? Two, commit to it, even if it's a little audacious. And then three is that we give. We just do it together. We say, hey, God, this is what we're called to do, and this is what you've asked us to do, God. And so in this, you may go, John, it's $50,000. It's a lot of money. How do we do it? Well, if 200 people, which is roughly close to what we do on a weekend, if 200 people give $20 a month, we'll raise $48,000 in 1 year. So if everyone that comes here on the weekend, which that's just about a third of our church because people come to church about a third of the time. So we're a church of like 500 or 600 people right now. So if just a third of them commit to $20 a month, we'll raise all of it. We'll do it all, every bit of it. By the end of 2021, we'll do it. That's incredible. I don't know, it just makes it simple. If 20 people do $100 a month, and then 100 people do $20 a month. So if 20 of us say, hey, I can do $100 a month, we'll be at $48,000. So you see, it's not necessarily this, it sounds big and it is, but it's not necessarily so big and so heavy that I think it's possible. I do really do. And so today when you walked in, you would have got one of these pledge cards. And I want you to take it out and hold it right now, if you don't mind. And I want to read this scripture to you because this is the heart of what I'm getting at. What we're talking about here today. And this scripture is on your card. It says, then the people rejoiced because they had given willingly, for with a whole heart they had offered freely to the Lord. This conversation and what I'm proposing to you, what I'm casting the vision to you to today, this conversation should fit into this right here. If you're feeling pressure, don't do it. If you're feeling some sort of like John needs me or the church has to have this, don't do it. Because this conversation, when we give above and beyond our tithe, it should look like this. It should look like rejoicing, it should look like willingly, and it should look like freely. It should be something when we do it, we should go, man, I'm excited to see what God can do when I walk in obedience to him. And so today, if you feel like I'm manipulating you or trying to stir your emotions, which there's not a lot of background music to make it feel vibey or anything, we don't have any, there's none of that's happening. But if you feel like I'm pulling any strings, just don't, because that's not what we're doing here today. What we're doing is we're coming as a people of God and say, God, we want to rejoice because we want to give willingly and we want to give freely. I want to, when I do this, I want to go, God, I can't wait to see what you're going to do. And so put yourself in that category. This is our response. This is our attitude towards this. And this is what I want to do next. If you look on your card, there's a couple of different, name, all that kind of stuff. There's a total pledge. And on this, I want to explain this. The total pledge is the total amount that you hope to give over the course of the year. So let's say you're like, John, I'll do the $20 a month. 20 times 12, that's all my math whizzes. 240, come on. 20 times 12, I thought someone would say it out loud. Someone's doing this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 20 times 12. So if you say, John, I can do that. I can do $20 a month. That's $240. So that's what you'd write. That's my total pledge. I'm not giving all that today, but that's my total pledge. And then what you do is you'd mark monthly. And so then I would go, okay, so when we see these cards, we know how to report back to the church. This is where we're at. This is what we've done so far. So we'd be able to report back to the church. So far, we have pledged $25,000. Or so far, we have pledged $30,000. Doesn't mean we raised it that week. It means that over the course of the year, this is what we're going to be able to do from our phases. So you guys know when we hit these numbers, what we're doing next. There's no surprises. Being completely transparent, as we bring in this money, you've seen the things that we're doing. This is what we're going to accomplish this year. Is we're going to give weekly, so it'd still be your total amount, and then just mark weekly. You're going to see that come in. So our teams here would know, hey, they're going to see that come in a little bit out of week, per weekly. Or maybe you're doing just a one-time gift. You say, John, I just want to write a check and be done with it. I want to give $500 or $1,000 or $10,000, whatever it may be. And you would just mark that. And what that does, it just lets our team It's not that we're going to send you bills. We're not going to do that. We don't do that. This is between you and God. You pray, you commit, you give. This is just so our team knows how we can start looking to our future and seeing what we can start thinking about what's coming next for us. And then on the bottom, it's got a little perforated tab. And once you fill this out, don't fill it out yet, but once you fill this out, you can just tear this off. It's like a little bookmark. Put it in your Bible. If you don't do a paper Bible, maybe take the back of your phone cover off and slide it in there and put it back on. Just put it somewhere where you might see it occasionally, maybe in your car, where you can remember and recognize your commitment that you made to God to see this vision move forward. But before you fill it out, this is what I want you to do. If everyone would just stand up all across the room, we're going to pray, and then the worship team is gonna do one more song, and then I just got a quick like devotion message for you on Advent. But this is what I want you to do. While we're doing this song, I want you to pray. While you're singing, while they're singing, I want you to say, God, what is it that you're calling me to do? God, what is it, if I'm gonna walk into obedience, what does that look like? What's the number? And I believe that God can speak to you. I believe that God can tell you, can minister to you and give you the confidence knowing this is the thing that I'm called to do. And so then after that, you'll fill out the pledge card. After you feel like you know and you've made a commitment with God, fill out the pledge card. Then if you want to text to give, if that's your vibe, then you'll just, it's really easy. You'll text a dollar amount first. So you'd put 50, and then you just type the word heart. And you do that 50, heart, 84321, and it'd give $50 today. If you do 100 heart, 84321, whatever that may be. And then if you're gonna, maybe today you're like, John, I wanna pray about this. Maybe you're married and you need to go home, talk about with your spouse and like look at your finances. All of this information I shared today is already on our website. So you can go to vima.church/heart and you can look at that and go, hey, maybe there's something specific in that God's kind of tugging your heart that you, when you give, you're gonna be dreaming and thinking about the church ministering and doing these things. So this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna pray. And then as I pray, the worship team is gonna sing one more song. And I want you just to ask God, what is it that you're calling me to do? God, right now, we just come before you. And God, we thank you, God, that you, what you want to do in this church, you've already done. God, we can look back over this last year at our church. We can see that you've moved so faithfully already. God, you've already done so much, but God, we are just getting started. So God, today I pray as we pray and as we get ready to jump into this song, God, I pray that you would speak to us, God, that we would not give just from our own thoughts or our own processes, but God, we would really ask you, God, what is it that you're calling me to do? What is it that you're calling me to give? And God, I pray that you would speak that to us. And God, I pray as me and my family, God, as we step into this and we're gonna give sacrificially, we're stepping into this with faith. God, I pray and I believe that you're gonna make a way for us to do this. God, that how we're stepping and how we're believing, God, it may seem like it's big for us, but God, it is not big for you. God, that what you wanna do in this church and what you wanna do in this city and what you wanna do around this world, God, you will do. God, all the resources are in your hand. And for that, we just say thank you, God. God, speak to us as we pray and we ask in Jesus' name.